hope you can hear me on this microphone. Is that, can you hear me properly? Yeah? Okay, thank you very much. Well, first of all, thank you very, very much for having me here. And thank you particularly that you're giving your trust to somebody from the UK, because I realise that the United Kingdom is currently in a particularly good position to give other countries advice on matters of politics and strategy, etc. So there are going to be a lot of things to share on this point of view. I'm sorry to be switching track completely, because from this it's going to be a very difficult to follow this fascinating and extremely rich and informative lecture on China today. I was asked to talk about Deterrence and the Cold War, so we're now going back to history. If you fall asleep, I don't hold it against you. History and the nuclear guarantee and the Cold War. The interest of the matter is, however, that in some respects, as I will be showing you, we seem to be coming back full circle to a situation of potentially the 1990s. So let me start with some basics. I see a lot of faces in the room who will be reminded merely by what I say and will know everything that I say from their own experience, but I also see a lot of faces of young people who really haven't lived through this period, for whom some of this may be new. So let us start with a question of where, of this whole issue of nuclear deterrence, is there such a thing as a nuclear guarantee in NATO? Allow me to take you back to the beginning, the origins of NATO, where the British and the French in particular, together with the Benelux country, formed a small organization, the Western Union, in 1948, and inserted in it an amazing paragraph, because this paragraph, I think, amounts to a partial surrender of sovereignty. A partial surrender of sovereignty, because at least the signatories, by agreeing on this particular text, gave away their right to do less than everything, using all the military and other aid and assistance in their power, if one of them was attacked. It's a way of surrendering the right to even calibrate what they would do in defense of each other. It says they should use all the military and other aid and assistance in their power. Yeah, this is an extremely far-reaching guarantee, and this was signed 3 years after the end of the Second World War, obviously in the context of a Second World War which had come about in the memories or in the minds of many of the participants, partly because there hadn't been such a guarantee, there hadn't been a proper mutual defense pact of any sorts in the interwar period. So this is, in a way, an acte manqué. It is making up for something that happened in the past. But even then, when it was signed in 1948, there was still fear of a German revival. So in fact, that was written into the Western Union Treaty signed in 1948. But it is also, that was already done with an eye to a possibility of a conflict with the Soviet Union. So this was an extremely far-reaching mutual guarantee. This Western Union has been called a sprat to catch a mackerel. I hope that as a fishing nation, Norwegians will appreciate this metaphor. The idea was therefore to have a small commitment, a small pact by a small group of Europeans to prove to the Americans that they were worthy of the cooperation with America. And in fact, the British and the French went to the Americans, and this is the famous story of the empire by invitation. The British and the Americans and the French begged to the Americans to come in on this pact, to enhance it with another pact, and to become the guarantors of Europe. Now, when the Americans negotiated this, was negotiated in Washington, also in 1948, and then leading up to April 1949, the US Congress says there's no way we will surrender sovereignty in this fashion. There is no way we will make such an enormous commitment, such an unconditional commitment. So when the Washington Treaty, i.e. the treaty that founded the North Atlantic Treaty, NATO, was negotiated, the Americans insisted that this Article 5 that you've just seen had to be toned down considerably. It had to be reduced. So the famous Article 5 reads that the parties agree that an armed attack is against one will be an attack against everybody. That's fine. But if such an armed attack occurs, and this is where the red bit comes in, they will each of them, i.e. individually, exercise the right of individual or collective self-defense, individually and in concert with the other parties, and they will take such action as each of them deems necessary, including the use of force, of armed force, to restore and maintain the security, which means that on the day such action that it deems necessary could be the American Congress saying, Mr. President, you have our permission to write a very strong letter of protest. It could be all out nuclear use. It could be anything. Yeah? It, on the day, it will be whatever that country decides. So in fact, this is not a nuclear guarantee. It has been argued by the British in the Cold War that this was a nuclear guarantee, that this what meant, if Britain was a nuclear power, it meant that that meant that this implied a nuclear guarantee to its partners in the Western Union, whereas this is clearly, from the point of view of just the text, not a nuclear guarantee. But whatever you do, you need the infrastructure to do it. So if you have a very vague guarantee or very vague commitment, you can still enhance it enormously by putting into Europe or in some way providing what it needs to implement this particular commitment, should you feel like that on the day. And if you don't do that, then the nicest piece of text is useless. So there is this complement. There are these two things that need to go together on the one hand, or three things that need to go together. The piece of paper, the infrastructure, the kit, the hardware to implement it, and on the day, the political will. So the USA did provide the infrastructure, the manpower, the weapon systems, the nuclear weapons that would enable it, on grosso modo altogether, to deter aggression against NATO allies, and that was always part of the basic reason for all of this. The idea was if they could defend Europe in this way, if they had the nuclear weapons, if they had the manpower and the conventional forces, this would deter an attack, and if deterrence failed to defend NATO allies on all levels, if it chose to do so on the day. So while the NATO Article 5 commitment is an awful lot weaker than the Western Union commitment, the United States did actually pay up and put this enormous investment in terms of infrastructure, manpower, weapon systems, etc., into Europe in order to make the possibility, engender the possibility on the day to do what they, in theory, could envisage doing if they felt like that on the day. So now to deterrence in the Cold War. Again, apologies to all of those who are old nuclear strategy hands and who know all this, but I'm sure that you haven't thought about this for quite a while because there was a whole period when we thought we didn't have to worry so much about nuclear weapons. So let's get back to deterrence how. What was deterrence about? And my favorite formula to summarize, and a huge literature written about this, and to simplify, as I like simplifications when they stand up, is one that was produced by Pierre-Marie Gallois in France, who said deterrence is the threat times credibility. So, if the threat is enormously terrifying, nuclear war, then you actually only need relatively little credibility for deterrence to stand. If you have a conventional fighting power, the credibility that you're going to use it is much greater, but then conventional fighting power may not be as much as a deterrent and as much of a worry to the other side as nuclear war would be. So you can make deterrence can work in ways other than with nuclear weapons. In fact, it would be more credible if you'd put, if you complement nuclear weapons by conventional forces. But even relying on nuclear weapons, they are so dreadful that even a small credibility will establish deterrence. Now, the factor has to be larger than zero. So, as the French discovered, it does not help when their president, or if somebody who has just been their president on leaving office said, I would never have used nuclear weapons, which is what Giscard d'Estaing did. It does not help if there is a television program currently available on RuTube, which is the Russian equivalent to YouTube, in case you didn't know, which is called World War III Inside the War Room, the famous BBC television program in which a whole lot of people sitting who had been, who were either active politicians at the time this was made 2 years ago, I think, or were recently retired high-ranking officers or diplomats sitting around a BBC studio played through a scenario that had been played in NATO just recently, just a year earlier, in which they decide at the end not to use nuclear weapons, even in retaliation to Russian use. So that sort of thing is not helpful for deterrence. So you don't say, I wouldn't ever use them. If you're Jeremy Corbyn, for example, and you say, I would never use nuclear weapons, and you become Prime Minister, should you become Prime Minister of the United Kingdom, you don't have much of a deterrent stance, so that's not helpful for deterrence. However you're going to do, however moral or amoral it is, but it doesn't help deterrence, that's where we're starting. Okay. So let me just take you very briefly through successive NATO postures. This is summarizing a very long spiel, and I'll just try to talk you through it very briefly. The very first one was to, if the Soviet Union attacked and its satellites, there was no Warsaw Pact yet, this was late 1940s, early 1950s, NATO's strategy would have been led by American strategy to fend off aggression with forces deployed in Europe, while bombing with anything they had, which was very little, major Soviet cities, because that was the only thing that American bombers could have reached with freefall bombs, and there was only a handful at the time that the Americans had. Then came in 1954, massive retaliation, which in fact was the introduction of battlefield nuclear weapons, with the hope that that meant that it would be easier with a limited number of forces, conventional forces on the ground in Europe, to actually fend back a Soviet invasion and satellite invasion on the ground, while at the same time still continuing to do what they had imagined in the first strategy, namely try to bomb major Soviet cities from the air with bombers. 1957 saw the introduction, after the Hungarian story and the Soviet and Warsaw Pact invasion of Hungary, of a slightly different approach, because the realization had come in the meantime that one had to plan for different scenarios. And this was, to everybody's confusion, don't try to remember this, or just go read my book if you really want the details. It was the first time that people talked about flexible response, but they meant by it horses for courses, i.e. different reactions or different scenarios, which would have been, had there been a small local incursion into NATO territory, NATO would have tried to fend that back with conventional forces, and if there was a proper all-out war, they would deal with it differently, with both conventional and battlefield nuclear and strategic nuclear forces. But then came Sputnik, and the Sputnik shock, which was that the Americans suddenly realized that they were vulnerable to intercontinental Soviet ballistic missiles. And from that moment onwards, and this is important for us, this is where you have to start listening again, today's situation gradually came in, which is that Europeans, and in fact many American strategists, began to doubt that America would actually use nuclear weapons in defense of Europe if they themselves, in retaliation, would suffer for this. So in the very early 1960s, American diplomats and high-ranking officials traveled through Europe and said, could we not change NATO's strategy to be one in which we will try to match the Warsaw Pact's conventional forces symmetrically, so that we could actually try to defeat the Soviet Union, a Soviet and Warsaw Pact invasion conventionally in Europe? Could we not try to build up our conventional forces and try this an asymmetric approach rather than threatening to use nuclear weapons? To which the Europeans said, thank you very much. Actually, we had something like that. It was called the Second World War, and no, we would not like to repeat it. And this is why we quite like nuclear weapons. We quite like to deter such a war rather than have run the risk of fighting it. So this was very difficult. This was possibly the most difficult period for NATO ever. It resulted in France leaving the integrated military structure because of this precise argument that they couldn't possibly trust the Americans to defend them with nuclear weapons, develop their own nuclear weapons. And it became a very rocky period, the 1960s, in which the Americans were very much trying to impose the Non-Proliferation Treaty, and the Europeans were trying to say, no, we need to have an alternative to an American guarantee. We don't actually think it's going to work. The day was saved more or less with an awful lot of British input, and this is why, you know, Britain for such a long time was such an extremely important country in NATO and such an important leader and such an important bridge across the Atlantic, because it was Britain that came up largely with the idea of what was flexible response number three, which was the idea that if deterrence broke down, yes, one would make some efforts on the ground to defend NATO area conventionally, But one had to introduce, before this became World War II type confrontation on a conventional scale, one would try to bring in what is, has been referred to as intra-war deterrence, that the attempt to restore deterrence, which had clearly failed, otherwise the Warsaw Pact, the Soviet Union wouldn't have invaded, and how would you do that by a limited use of nuclear weapons, but in a fashion, and I'll come back to that in a second, in a fashion that would force the adversary to rethink and force upon them a decision-making process in which one would hope they would agree to an armistice. So that was what was finally known as flexible response, and it was actually embraced by NATO in 1967. Let me just dwell for a second on the European alternative to this, which was the MLF, the Multinational Nuclear Force. Now, you see that, remember, the Europeans were very worried that the Americans would not implement a nuclear strike. And in fact, the multilateral nuclear force sailed. What was done was that they had the USS Claude V. Ricketts, that ship over there, was equipped with a multinational team of sailors. And the idea was that they might force, in the event, I mean, this was not spelled out, but the point was that they might override any resistance on the part of the Americans on board to use these nuclear weapons which were deployed on board this ship in defense of Europe. The Americans, of course, had actually got their own people on board as well, so they would hope that this wouldn't be, they couldn't be overridden. But in any case, the whole thing was supposed to help the Europeans have confidence in American nuclear use, by having nuclear weapons used which were not deployed in American territory, might therefore not provoke retaliatory strikes against the United States, but would somehow be based on joint decision making and would make joint decision making on nuclear use more credible. Mm-hmm. So this thing actually was sailed, but was sunk by particularly British and French reluctance about it and confederations. But I just want to flag one thing, which was that in the process of the 1960s, when the non-proliferation treaty was negotiated, the resistance against the non-proliferation treaty, particularly on the part of France and Germany, who signed very late and ratified even later than the other countries, was that they were desperately hoping to establish a European nuclear force, particularly the Germans and the Italians, and that there was always this idea that if we don't have the American guarantee, we must do something by ourselves. But in fact, this is crucial, the United Kingdom came in a big way and tried, again, in this context, salvage the show, because the United Kingdom, from about that point onwards, until the end of the Cold War, used to weigh in and say, but look, we have given you this guarantee in the Western Union Treaty, in the Brussels Treaty. This guarantee we take seriously. We, being part of Europe, would hesitate less than the Americans to use nuclear weapons. We would probably use them earlier. We are a European nuclear force. We are a European country. We are part of the Western Union. And we would use them to defend you, even if the Americans are hesitating. Now, how could you prove this? Well, you couldn't. But in military exercises and in staff exercises, etc., the scenario was very frequently that British would use it. It started off with battlefield nuclear weapons, but afterwards fighter planes with nuclear weapons on board, free-fall bombs, would use nuclear weapons before the Americans did, and would thus be able to signal to the other Europeans, don't pursue this idea of a multilateral nuclear force. We're here to protect you. It is interestingly, that the French didn't go that way. Remember, this was the time when the French were outside the integrated military structure, and the French, even when they came back in, didn't join the nuclear planning group, which was also set up at the instigation of the British, because the nuclear planning group in NATO was supposed to reassure allies about the sort of thinking that the Americans and the British would have behind nuclear use, so as to assure them that they meant it seriously and that they had certain targeting principles which were acceptable also in theory to the others, and that they would listen to the complaints of others, etc. So very crucially, the fact that Britain was part of this WEU and was part of NATO made this "we will protect you" stance much more credible. Just for your information, of course, the WEU was more or less dissolved in 2011 and was subsumed into the Lisbon Treaty, i.e. this commitment is part of the Lisbon Treaty, which means that by leaving the European Union, that particular British commitment, gone. Now, in this context, what was the purpose of any first use as agreed by NATO from 1969 onwards in this nuclear planning group? The idea was to reconstitute deterrence. And here I'm back to my topic. Reconstitute deterrence in this intra-war deterrence idea, the idea being that deterrence had clearly failed if the Warsaw Pact had attacked. Therefore, the leaders of the Warsaw Pact, in other words, the Kremlin, clearly had miscalculated the willingness of NATO to resist. Therefore, one had to disabuse them of the notion that NATO was unwilling to defend itself, and therefore one had to show very forcefully that one was willing to go all the way up to nuclear use. Now, how would you do this nuclear use? Lots of discussions about this, years of discussions in the nuclear planning group. And the agreement that was, or the consensus that was found was that the aim of any such nuclear use would have to be primarily political. It would be to make the adversary think again, as it says in the unofficial Scottish National Hymn. It's make them think again, make them reconsider what they're doing, make them realize that they're not succeeding and that they have to stop in their tracks and reconsider. But how would you do that? How would you practically do that? All sorts of ideas were floated, like what about a one-off nuclear explosion above the Baltic Sea, which would kill nobody? The answer to that was it would show irresolution rather than resolution. So let's do something they thought that would really make sense and have a hard impact. Why not go for something that would truly stop oncoming Soviet and Warsaw Pact military in their tracks, and seriously do some damage to oncoming military groups, but try at the same time to avoid high-value targets. So you wouldn't want to make the adversary desperate by destroying cities and large numbers of civilian lives or historical buildings and things like that, but you would try to hit military targets in such quantity or with such effect that the adversary had to do something to fill that gap. So classic targeting idea would have been, while Warsaw Pact second echelon forces are crossing crucial river crossing points to reinforce the first echelon, try to hit them there when there is a choke point where they have to come together and you can get lots at the same time. It would be a very clear signal that you are targeting military and not civilian, if you can find such a point that is not also a city. And at the same time, you would force the Warsaw Pact leadership to reconsider or to consider how to fill that particular gap that you've created. Reallocate forces, what to do, and that idea that would force decision-making upon them gives them an opportunity, or would give them an opportunity for somebody to say, are we doing the right thing here? Hopefully. That was the reckoning. And the idea was, the hope then was that somebody would say, shouldn't we rather stop here and have an armistice? This whole idea was reiterated. This was really more or less the same logic that prevailed until even the end of the Cold War. And now, again, let's look at those first-use weapons. What sort of weapons were available for that? You had the aircraft with free-fall bombs, UK. You had the French developed aircraft with standoff missiles. You had the land-based missiles, which would be stationed in several NATO ally countries. And you had the requirement of precision that you could limit collateral damage and limit misunderstandings. But the problem was this was not actually, these weapons that had been deployed in the 1960s had been scrapped in the meantime, and there wasn't in fact the technology when these the preliminary provisional guidelines for the use of nuclear weapons by NATO in 1969 were first formulated. The weapons were not, the technology wasn't available to actually carry out what NATO had agreed. So in fact, it was only from the late 1970s that that sort of weapons technology with the amount of precision that was required became available, and that was the rationale for the deployment of cruise and Pershing missiles in the early 1980s, to be that precise system of weapons stationed on European soil so that you could show that the countries on whose soil it was stationed showed solidarity for the whole project, and that could be used very quickly in order to signal to the Soviet Union, we really mean business, we are going to use nuclear weapons, the GPGs, the General Political Guidelines for the first and follow-on use of nuclear weapons by NATO, the same reasoning was also developed for any second salvo of strikes if the Soviet and Warsaw Pact forces hadn't been stopped. So these are the weapons, and this is what was used. And that was the background to the INF deployment that took place in the early 1980s. And the INF deployment, and this is the bit that you will now find very interesting and coming back to now. This is where we're getting back to the politics of today, because there were two different rationales for those weapons. One is the rationale I've just explained to you, to have these weapons that would induce a reconsideration on the part of the adversary and might lead to an armistice, one would hope, might lead to the restoration of deterrence, i.e. intra-war deterrence. And the other one was, that was the flexible response idea, have a land-based position for first credible first use option. And the second one was what was released or launched by German Chancellor Helmut Schmidt, who in 1977 gave a talk at the International Institute of Strategic Studies in London, in which he said, and he linked them to the Soviet procurement of SS-20 weapons. And there he said, we have a gap, because the NATO European countries did not have any weapons of that particular reach at that stage. We have a gap in our seamless deterrence, what's supposed to be seamless deterrence, while the Soviets are acquiring a new weapon system of that reach. We don't have anything equivalent, and we should have something equivalent. You see, that's a completely different rationale. That's a rationale of they have it, so we must have it, keeping up with the Joneses. It was not a rationale that had anything to do with we need particular weapons for a particular strategic task. Yeah? From which followed in eventually NATO's dual track decision to say we will acquire those weapons unless the Soviet Union agrees to withdraw its SS-20. And that's what we're just hearing Trump do now. That's exactly what we're hearing Trump do now. Yeah? While the reasoning for these particular weapon systems, in fact, led NATO at the very same time when they came up with this to get rid of 2,200 weapons missiles that didn't serve any strategic purpose from the point of view of this idea of what we really need is strategic nuclear weapons that can reach and devastate the Soviet Union, but also these weapons which could restore intra-war deterrence with the hope that we could actually break off escalation and that it wouldn't go off to a total all-out nuclear war. So this reasoning that was there also for the Euro missiles, as they were called, the Cruise and Pershing, made a lot of strategists very miserable when in 1987 Reagan and Gorbachev agreed that they would, in fact, eliminate the Euro missiles and the SS-20. Because the Western strategists were saying, but these are the weapons we would actually be using. They're the most useful weapons. They are not battlefield nuclear weapons which would destroy mainly the Federal Republic of Germany. They are not weapons that would immediately lead to all-out nuclear war and terrible total retaliation on the side of the Soviet Union, who would strike back because their own Moscow and Leningrad, etc., would be destroyed. But it's just the sort of weapon system that we really might consider using that would actually be credible to use because of their precision and because our ability then to hit follow-on forces in a way that is credible. So these were the most deterrent weapons. So strategists were pretty dismal when this came about. I remember witnessing this whole story in 1987. But after all, then we went to an elimination also of the battlefield nuclear weapons, and the Cold War was over, and the story was happy, and we all thought that this was a good thing. Okay, so back to the current situation. So what was, just to repeat, what happened in 1987, the weapons that were would have been most credible to be used were eliminated, and what we're left with are the British and the French were very keen to lie low during those negotiations in order to protect their own weapon systems that could fulfill just that task from any arms control agreement, which is why you still had at that stage then British gravity bombs that would have been used from British fighter planes and French aircraft with standoff missiles. So what's left now, this is gone. So again, you know, this whole big role that was played by United Kingdom in the Cold War to make sure that the deterrent credibility of the alliance stood up has been very much undermined by that. And the only forces that are left now is the French aircraft with their standoff missiles and, of course, the US bombers with their gravity bombs. So, and as those are in need of modernization, or those would have been in need of modernization anyway, there would have been a debate now anyway, even if we hadn't had the situation that the Americans claim the Russians are infringing the INF treaty with new missiles that they're, and cruise missiles that they're developing. Interesting footnote, and we always have a good chuckle about this when I'm together with Russians, is of course that the Russians have adopted the whole NATO rationale of what sort of thing they would do in any first use, namely that it is an escalation to de-escalate, they call it, which is a very nice way of putting it, and I've had Russian Soviet military strategists admit to me that this is, yes, copying the NATO one. I think the difference is that the Russians would probably be using them in larger numbers, but I haven't got proper sources on this, I've only got hearsay. So if the INF treaty is scrapped, we may be back to the 1980s in many respects. But the question is now, with the Trump administration, would the Americans want to do this in the first place? You know, the configuration in Washington is such that I don't really know where this debate is going to be. I think the Washington elite would want to do it, but the elite counters nothing in respect to what the president thinks on the day, and we have seen this extremely large circulation and rotation of personnel in and out of the White House, so we don't really know. We do know that it's the president who has the ultimate say on this and nobody else. Thank you very much for your attention, and if you wanted any more details on this, this is the division. I've got the NATO strategies explained in greater detail there, and this is the last thing that we've published a couple of years ago about the possible debate and the pros and cons of the various sides that would invariably come up again if we are going to be talking about a renewal of American stationing or the INF treaty being scrapped and being replaced by American INF in Europe or what could happen there. Thank you very much for your attention.